about with great ease.
I am indeed proud and privileged to present before you a well-known and highly respected teacher of Vedanta in India and abroad, the president of Arshya Vidya Gurukulam, Salisbury, USA, and the founder of the Tattva Tirtha Ashrama in Ahmedabad, Swami Vidhidatmanandaji of the Adhyatma Vidya Mandir. It was in the late 70s that Swamiji, who was working as an engineer in New York, met his guru and was so impressed by his teachings that he gave up his job and studied the complete Shastras and Sanskrit language, following which he returned to Gujarat and started teaching Vedanta. Swamiji is a man of wisdom who not only abides in the self, but also commands the rare art of unfolding its true nature to the seekers, bringing home the subtle truths of Vedanta in a style which is simple, lucid, and yet penetrating in Swamiji's thought. He has been teaching Vedanta for nearly 3 decades in India and US, an embodiment of love, compassion, simplicity, and straightforwardness. Swamiji is a Mahatma to the core. In today's jet age, with the rapid advance of technology, we are witnessing vast changes in the field of education, and values, culture, and tradition have taken a back seat. In keeping in tune to the situation, Swamiji will today enlighten us on how to help our children reflect the values learned in their daily attitude and behavior and become contributing ethical citizens. Dear ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together and join me in welcoming a great teacher of Vedanta, a prolific author, and a sannyasi who has inspired millions, Pujya Swami Vidhidatmanand Saraswati Ji.
Sahanavavatu, Sahanau Bhunaktu, Sahaviryankaravavahai, Tejasvinavadhitamastuma Vidvishavahai. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. The importance of value education, meaning communicating the importance of living a life based on values, has always been important, but maybe particularly important at this time in the world and also in India, where we find a great violation of values, lots of scams going on, lot of violence going on, lot of abuse going on. All of this shows that the basic values are violated In this, we have lots of violence around ourselves, not only India, around the world. And it spreads sorrow, misery, unhappiness everywhere. Therefore, to live a peaceful life, which also brings about prosperity, what is important to understand is the prosperity that we wish in our life. The wealth, the fame, the power, which are the marks of success and which is what everyone wants. We cannot grudge the ambition that a person has, the desires that a person has, that they want to live a more comfortable, more enjoyable life. All of these are legitimate desires. But then there are legitimate ways of fulfilling desires and not legitimate ways of fulfilling desires. As long as we manage desires, so long it would be possible to have the patience and inner strength to follow the legitimate means. However, when we are controlled by desires, as long as I control the desire, so long I decide how I want to fulfill my desire, then I have a freedom of choice which every human being has. You have the free will or freedom to choose in every situation and choose between what I want to, I should do and what I should not do. What is the right thing to do and what is not the right thing to do? Usually, everybody knows this in every situation. Meaning that, what is truthfulness, what is honesty, is known to everyone. There could be situations where it is not clear, the values need to be interpreted in every situation. Meaning that it is not a given behavior which is called honesty. It's not a given action that is called non-violence. It is the interpretation of that value in a given situation, at a given time, place and condition. We'll come to that. But basically, we are all reasonably well educated to understand what the value is and what it means in a given situation. In case it is not clear, you can always consult somebody. But then having understood what is the right way of doing, what's the right thing to do in a given situation, sometimes the inner pressure from within, which may force me to take a way which is not right, even though I know it is not right. Even though I may know that to take advantage of this person who is vulnerable is not right, to hurt this person who is vulnerable is not right, to hide something is not right. I know these things. But sometimes the pressure inside of my ambitions, my desires, is so much that I find myself violating what I know is right. And I deliberately do, or knowingly do what is not right. This is what we want to address. What we mean by abuse of values is deliberately doing something which is not right in my own understanding. It is possible that my understanding may not be right and therefore what I do may not be right. It's a different thing. But when I understand what is right and still I do the opposite, that we call the violation of value. The basis of value is very simple. As human beings, we are self-conscious beings. And I'm quite conscious of what I like and what I dislike. I like that I should be treated kindly, not cruelly. I should be forgiven, not punished. Others should be kind to me, not cruel to me. This is very clear to me, is it not so? Everybody wants others to be kind to them. Everybody wants others to be honest to them. Everybody wants others to be truthful to me. And this is universal, meaning every human being has this expectation of how he or she should be treated by others. We are all very clear and in agreement also. I don't want to be hurt. So, my teacher, Pujya Swami Dayananji, was addressing an audience like this. And he was fond of asking the audience, is there someone here who wants to be hurt? Is there someone here who wants to be lied to? Someone wants to be violated? Is there someone who wants to be hurt? He knows the answer. There is nobody going to say, I want to be hurt. Nobody wants to be hurt. One day was surprised. Somebody who already said, yes, I like to be hurt. Now Swamiji is very embarrassed, you know, because a universal rule should not have any violation, exception. So Swamiji was presenting a universal rule that applies to all living beings, that nobody wants to be hurt. Not dogs and cats and mosquitoes also. Nobody wants to be hurt. If someone says, I want to be hurt, that means there is an exception to the rule. It's not a universal rule then. Fortunately, audience came to his rescue. Someone from the audience got up and said, Swamiji, don't worry. He has some problem. Meaning that what we call normal people are all in agreement that we don't want to be hurt by others, we don't want to be cheated by others. I don't want people to steal what belongs to me. We are conscious about it. Then, second aspect of the self-consciousness is that I know that you also do not want to be hurt by me. This is where the problem comes. As long as the one-sided consciousness is concerned, that I do not want to be hurt by you, we are all in agreement. But unfortunately or fortunately, I'm aware that you also expect me not to hurt you. The kind of treatment I expect from you is the kind of treatment that you expect from me, and I'm aware of that. So I know that you do not want to be hurt, and still if I hurt, because of some inner pressure, we usually violate the values only when there is inner pressure. No pressure, no violation of values. If traffic is all going on very smoothly, nobody ever, cuts off anybody. But when there is traffic jam and then, I'm in a hurry, or I'm always in a hurry anyway. Indians are always in a hurry, at least on the road. When they go to work, then the hurry disappears somewhere. On the road, everybody is in a hurry. Everybody wants to be first. And then you take anyway a pressure. So just on one hand, we have awareness of what is right thing to do, meaning that I should treat others as I want to be treated by them. This is, we are aware of that. And as long as everything is going on well, that's what I do also. Understand that nobody willingly wants to violate value. Nobody willingly wants to be violent. Nobody willingly wants to be dishonest. Nobody willingly wants to abuse others. You'll be surprised to know this. Even a person whom we call a criminal also doesn't love criminality. Doesn't love violence. Because inherently we are non-violent people. Inherently we are truthful people. Inherently we are good people. Every human being is inherently good, kind, loving, beautiful person. So when we find cruelty which seems to be opposed to kindness, that shows not my real nature, it shows some kind of a pressure which compels me to act in a way against my nature. Understand the word compulsion, you know, call it pressure or compulsion. Meaning that given a choice, I will not tell a lie. Given a choice, I will not hurt anybody. Given a choice, I will not cheat, because that's what my nature is. But then, if there is some pressure, some compulsion, because being truthful involves too much of a loss, let us say. When customs people ask me, Swamiji, what are you carrying in your bags? This is 30 years ago, nowadays it's 30, 40 years ago. Those days there was a lot of restriction on what you could bring from abroad. All electronic items were heavy, taxed. Swami has two big bags. Customs officer very politely asks me, anything to declare, Swamiji? If I say no, go ahead. If I say yes, I have some dutiable goods to declare, then he will open my bags. Count every shirt, then they will count everything, including some shirt which I may have bought, everything, and come up with a duty of 100,000 rupees and penalty of 100,000 rupees and some other, like, if I tell the truth, it cost me 2 lakhs. This is 30 years ago, when there's a lot of money. Nowadays 2 lakhs may not be a big deal. So now the conflict arises in a Swami. Should I tell the truth? Or should I simply make a serious face and so I have nothing to declare and begging Swami, he trusts me, let me go. What would you do? Your choice to tell the truth, lie and save lakhs of rupees and tell the truth and sacrifice a lot of money, what will you do? Can somebody tell me? What will you do? I know what you will tell me. Whether you will do that or not is a different matter. What would you do? Swamiji, I will tell the truth and I will, you know, sacrifice my 2 lakhs of rupees. I'm sure that's what you would say. But when that time comes, there is one part in me which tells me, Swami, tell the truth. Because you are talking about values and truthfulness and this is your time now. And so you tell the truth. That's one part of me tells me. Because that's the honest part. That's my true nature. There is another part, unfortunately, in us. There are two opposing forces. In Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna describes them as the divine tendencies and the demoniac tendencies, the Devi Sampat, the Asuri Sampat. Asuram is demon. Unfortunately, in each one of us, we have divine wealth. We are all kind, compassionate, loving, beautiful, honest people. That's our nature. Unfortunately, we also have this demoniac tendency, this anger also in us, this greed also, this lust also. Kamaha, krodaha, tatha lobaha, Lord Krishna says. Kamaha, lust, krodaha, anger, lobha, greed. Naragasiram dwaram, Lord Krishna says, these three are your inner enemies and they cause all the misery in your life. All the sorrow and misery which you experience in your life has its source in these three, kama, krodha and lobha. Tasmat etat trayam tyajet. So Lord Krishna says, we will give up these three. So, now who pressurizes me to violate the value? This kama, krodha and lobha. When it comes to customs officer and telling the truth, which was the pressure? The lobha, the greedy one in me tells me, Swamiji, doesn't matter, tell him, you don't have anything. You save a lot of money. And you know, Swamis always need money, looks like, they're always fundraising. So why do you want to waste your money? So greed tells me, sometimes anger compels me, sometimes lust compels me. Compulsions, the tendency to indulge compels me. So this is where we have what we call the violation of values, you follow? We see lot of violation of values everywhere. In a country like India, it may be very gross and everybody gets affected by that. Even normal life gets affected by that. The Western countries, in a very sophisticated way, but the human beings are not too different from each other, unfortunately. Thus, we have a crisis. Forget about the world. We should talk about ourselves. That in our own life also, there is a crisis. That we find ourselves sad, unhappy, depressed. We do not realize the cause of it. Why do I feel sad? Why am I bored? Why am I depressed? We will not understand. But the reason is, kamaha, krodaha, lobaha. They are the cause of all sorrow, sadness, unhappiness, depression, conflicts. Because what is in my mind also gets reflected in my behavior. It also reflects in my relationships. So my anger spills out in my behavior and therefore it has others. So these inner enemies that we have, all of us have, in varying measure. Some people may have more of them, others may have less of them, but nobody is an exception. Therefore, to live a happy life, what we want is a very simple thing in our life. What we want is a very simple thing. Can somebody tell me what we want in our life? Peace? What else? Satisfaction. Huh? Satisfaction. Very good. Happiness, right. But how about $1,000,000? How about becoming a political leader? How about having also power and prestige and fame and wealth? That also we want, is it not so? It's all part of happiness. So we want wealth and fame and power for the sake of happiness or unhappiness, tell me. So understand now. Now that we want two things, understand. One is we want happiness. Other is we want also wealth and fame and power, isn't it? Because they bring happiness, is it not so? So number one, we want happiness, but there is an equation in our mind. What is the equation? Happiness is equal to wealth and fame and power. Is it not so? I mean, even if you say, no, I am not going to accept it that easily. You know? Why do people come to school of management school and stuff like that? What are they? The simple interest, you know, is this only. Everybody, why do you want to go to college and, you know, at least, why do you want education? For job. Why do you want job? For income. And to rise in the hierarchy and to ultimately become powerful, famous, whether we become or not, but that's what we want, is it not so? That's the desire behind all sorts of things that we do, is it not so? Even you play cricket, today is going to be this ODI. What for? For victory. Not for playing. Nowadays you don't play sport. You play to win, is it not so? So sledging is also okay, and this is some ball tampering. Everything is okay. Why is it okay? Because what is important is victory. What is happiness? Victory is happiness. Is it not so? Defeat cannot be happiness. Is it not so? Victory is happiness, right? And therefore, you do whatever is required for victory, and that may involve so this equation that happiness equals success, victory means happiness, wealth means happiness, power means happiness, fame means happiness. That is an equation, a standard equation. And therefore, in reality, what we want is happiness. But because we equate happiness with these things, we want those things because they are the means of happiness, right? Isn't it? But then, let me ask you, I will suggest, you please take private interviews of people who you think are successful. I will not, these are all different people, you know, but I'm talking about the worldly people. The wealthy, the famous, the powerful, who are successful. You ask them, are you happy? If you privately ask, then he will say, most likely, I don't think so. Do you have peace of mind? How are your relationship? How is your relationship with your spouse? How do you relate with the children? How do you relate with the friends? How are you able to relax during the holiday, or are you able to enjoy your, you know, traveling, etc.? Are you able to enjoy the things that you have? You should ask. I think you must have read various books where people have confessed that even though I am successful by the world standard of the wealth and fame, etc., but inwardly I do not enjoy, what is that satisfaction? What? Self-satisfaction I do not enjoy. What is important is self-satisfaction. Understand, what is happiness? Happiness means self-satisfaction. What does it mean? It means that I should be satisfied with myself. Understand this very fundamental thing, that when am I happy? When I am satisfied with myself. Now, when would I be satisfied with myself? Or when would I be satisfied with anything? I can be satisfied with something provided it meets with my expectation. When would I be satisfied with something? When it meets with my expectation. So you get an admission in a given school and you are satisfied if it meets your expectation. You like a job provided it meets with expectation. Similarly also, when would I be satisfied with myself? When I meet with my own expectation of myself. So understand this another thing. That we always expect things. Not only do we expect things from others, but we have expectations of ourselves also. In fact, my first expectation is from my own self. When you pose for a picture, what they call photo op. Swamiji, here, look here. I see a camera in his hand or a cell phone. Right away, you know what do I do? I bring a smile on my face. But there it is. How do I like to see myself? When I pose, do I smile or do I do something like this? Do I like that kind of a picture? No, unless I am playing in an act, you know, acting in a play or something, but otherwise. I like to see myself a smiling person, a kind person, not a cruel person. I don't like cruelty on my face, I like kindness on my face. Is it not so? Do you like yourself a kind person or a cruel person? A forgiving person or an angry person? An according person or an aggressive person? How do I like, whether I am aggressive or not, how do I like to see myself? I may not be what I like to be, but how do I like myself to be? A kind person, is it not? A giving person, a generous person, is it not so? An honest person, a truthful person. Understand that these are our expectations of ourselves. They are the values. So what I expect from myself itself becomes a value. That I like to see myself a kind person. I don't want to be a cruel person. I don't even want my picture to be appearing as a cruel person, you know. Therefore, when can I be satisfied with myself? When I meet with my own expectation of myself. And what are my expectations of myself? That I should be a kind person. Is it? Do you agree with me or do you think what I am saying makes sense? If it doesn't make sense, please raise your hand, then we can clarify. But my proposition is that each one wants to see ourselves as a kind, generous, compassionate person. Do you think so? That I do not like myself when I'm angry, cruel, small-minded, self-centered. I don't like to see myself that way. Would you agree? If you agree with that, then we come to the next step. That you said satisfaction is what we want, or I said self-satisfaction is what we want. When can I be satisfied with myself? When I'm able to meet with my own expectation of myself. What is my expectation of myself? That I should be a kind person. I should be a loving person. I should be a generous person. I should be a helping person. That's what I like myself to be. I may not be able to, but that's what I like. Therefore, whenever I find myself a kind person, I'm happy with myself. I'm satisfied with myself when I see myself a kind person, a loving person, a compassionate person. You think so? Look at your own experiences. When are you happy with yourself? When do I regret? When do I feel guilty? We do feel guilty sometimes, is it not so? I wish I had not said that. I wish I had not done it. Does it happen to us? When does it happen? I was very kind. I wish I had not done it. Would you say that? If you are kind, would you regret that you are kind? You were helpful to somebody. Would you regret that you were helpful to somebody? No. If you wind up hurting somebody, then we regret. Why did I say that? Why did I do that? Is it not? I feel guilty. That guilt shows what I expect from myself. That is, when I fail to live up to my own expectation, I feel unhappy with myself, feel guilty. Do we all experience? You know? So understand one simple formula. You can think about it further. What is simple formula? What we want in our life is happiness. Number two, we feel happy when we are satisfied with ourselves. Number three, we can be satisfied with ourselves provided we meet with our expectation from ourselves. Four, my expectation is I should be kind, compassionate, helpful person. No, Swamiji, I expect myself to be a wealthy person. I expect myself to be a powerful person. This is also unfortunate. That is also a thing. I expect, but because we have equation, wealth equal to happiness, power equal to happiness, fame equal to happiness. But through wealth and power, what you want is only happiness, is not so? So what is the means of being happy? Kindness is the means of being happy. Love is the means of being happy. To be helpful is a means of being happy. When I am saying this, if you have some question, you may raise your hand. No, Swami, I don't think so. I will seek some clarification. Otherwise, I believe that, you know, you understand what I am saying and I happily accept what I am saying. If this is so, this is called understanding how valuable a value is. Kindness is a value. Why is it value? Because it is means of happiness. Basic value is happiness in my life. You follow? And whatever makes me happy also becomes valuable. Kindness makes me happy, therefore kindness becomes valuable. You understand? Being helpful makes me happy. When you perform an act of kindness, just go out of your way and help somebody, which may involve a bit of strain on your part, but when you do that, how do you feel? You feel satisfaction, having done something right. You know why? Because if you were in that situation, you would have expected other person to help you. That shows that there is a universal order which connects us all in one way. What is the universal order? That each one of us wants happiness and that we are happy when we are satisfied with ourselves. That's when we are kind, compassionate, loving. So kindness, compassion, love, charity become values. Universal values, you follow? Because everyone loves that because that is what makes them happy. In fact, I should not even say kindness is a means of happiness. Kindness means happiness. You understand? Kindness means happiness. Compassion means happiness. Charity means happiness. No, Swamiji, I gave something to this person but I was not happy. That means not real charity. Sometimes behind that some other expectation may be there. Or what that person should do. I did so much for that person. So we did it not for doing but with some other expectation. But I am kind for the sake of being kind. Compassionate for the sake of being compassionate. That is who a happy person is. That does not mean that a wealthy person is not happy. That's not what I mean. Anybody can be happy. Wealthy or poor. Powerful or not. Healthy or not. Anybody can be happy provided that person is kind, compassionate, loving, charitable, truthful, honest. And nobody can be happy, regardless of what the outer situation is. One can be very powerful, very wealthy, very famous, but not necessarily happy if that person is not kind, if that person is not compassionate, if that person is not generous, if that person is not selfless, if that person is not helpful. Do you think that makes sense? Do you follow what I'm saying? Does it make sense? If it makes sense, then it should bring about a transformation of ourselves, complete transformation. Because values will change. Now, as I said, everything is fine, wealth, name, fame, all fine. The problem comes when there is money on one side and honesty on the other side. So what will you choose? Remember, you want to be happy. Remember that. Also remember that you will be happy when you have means of happiness. And remember that honesty is a means of happiness. Thus, if there is a choice between being honest and some profit or whatever, some money, a mature person, not everybody, but a person who has thought about it, who has understood this, assimilated this, has that maturity, that person will choose to be kind, even though it may involve some sacrifice of some worldly things. So this is where pinch comes, because we have two sets of values in our life. One are the universal values, as I said, kindness, compassion, goodness, which everybody agrees with. Others are the fame, power, wealth, because we are born and raised in a society where it is believed that that is what happiness is. Not only you, the whole world believes that happiness means success. And success means wealth, and power, and fame means success, means happiness. This is the equation upon the whole world works. And I see people around me following the same thing. So when I am raised, as a child, when I am raised in this society, I see people only following those things. What am I going to follow? Naturally. So people don't come to colleges, you know, schools, etc. To be honest, they come to be wealthy. They come to make money. They come to have income. They come to have worldly things. There's nothing wrong in that. But their means are not there. Unfortunately, those things have become end. They should be means. As long as wealth and power and fame is a means, so long it's fine. It's a wonderful thing to have. It empowers you. If that becomes an end, then it destroys you. Swamiji, this is what your theory is, that we don't find anybody being destroyed. You know, we find fellows, so many fellows, and he has run away into it. Now he's found in England, he has what? How many crores are we? Where is the problem? Other fellow, bigger than him, you know? So they have outright cheated people and they have run away from here and they seem to be enjoying themselves. Are they not? Are they not enjoying themselves? You think running away from pillar to post, from one place to the other and hiding, would that be enjoyment? That you never know when you will be spotted, when you will be arrested, when you are caught and when you are exposed. I mean, you think that that's enjoyment? You think you can enjoy peace of mind with that kind of a situation? I don't want to judge anybody, we don't want to brand anybody, you know, and I should not have given this example also, but somehow newspaper, this is what you read, and that's why it just came to my mind, and thinking that you all know these things. But you cannot equate that with happiness, understand? That is good to have, provided you are a... There are two ways of living life. One, our Swamiji's words are this. One is a consumer, other is a contributor. One is a consumer, other is a contributor. Who is a consumer? One who looks only for self-interest. And so he wants things from the world. He uses the world, he uses everything around him for his own personal benefit. They are called smart people, but that's a consumer. Other person is wants to be useful to the world. One wants to use the world for his self-satisfaction, gratification. Other one wants to be useful to the world. First one is called consumer, other is called contributor. So wealth and power is fine, provided it becomes a means of being a contributor. They become means of consumer. Then, you know, they don't destroy you. It's a whole mentality of being consumer is what makes us miserable. Not money. Nothing makes us miserable. They empower us. Money empowers us, power empowers us, fame empowers us. You can do a lot of things with them and you can be a great contributor. So don't have the equation that wealthy means unhappy. No such equation. Whoever is a contributor is a happy person. A consumer is an unhappy person. Whoever it is. A poor fellow also, a consumer unhappy, contributor happy. Who is a contributor? A kind, compassionate, charitable person is a contributor. A greedy, angry, etc., selfish is a consumer. So two sets of values, understand? Unfortunately, we all have those negative things within us. And therefore, every time you want to tell truth, you have to fight with somebody inside who wants to compel you to tell a lie because there is some material benefit involved. So these are acquired values for wealth and fame and power called acquired success, acquired value. Being contributor, being kind, compassion is a universal value. When there is a clash between the two, usually those acquired values win and this kindness, honesty is compromised because people do not understand what makes them happy. They think that the material things make them happy. In reality, these values make us happy. See, this is what the teachers would understand first. All of this is we communicate to children in the school. But when can we communicate? When we have understood and assimilated ourselves. That's the reason why we like to talk to teachers. And make them understand the value of values. You follow? Honesty is a value, but it's a valuable because it is a means of happiness. So these values of kindness are valuable because they are means of happiness. And what is opposed to them are the means of... You can be happy or unhappy, there is no middle path. No, so I don't want to be happy, I'll be okay. No, if you are not happy, then you know what you are? Unhappy. So that is how this basic introductory talk on the values of understanding the value of values. They're valuable to us because happiness is valuable to us. And I can be happy only when I'm able to live up to my expectation of being a person who follows the values. I like to be a contributor. I see, and when I see myself a consumer, I'm not happy with myself. When I see myself a dishonest person, I'm not happy with myself. When I see myself a cruel person, I am not happy with myself. The key thing is for me to be happy with myself. Then everything will be good. If I am satisfied with myself, I will be easily satisfied with others. If I am unhappy with myself, I am a complaining person, not happy. What kind of dal is today? What rice is there? What is this? What clothes you wear? Everything becomes a problem if I am a problem to myself. And everything is beautiful when I am happy with myself. Understand this basic reality of life. If you understand this, we think about it and convinced about it, then we can convince others. So teachers have to not only communicate what the values are, but communicate to the students in a manner that they see the value and they are convinced about it. You have to say this in their language. You may not be able to repeat these words to small children. But if you understand the basic principle, then you will know in what way to communicate. What is the group of people in front of you? What is their capacity to understand? And how to communicate? This is what you are taught anyway. That's what the teachers are taught. This is the value education is, to educate the children about the importance of values. Like Swachhata is a value. Now people who are 50 and above, you just can't do anything with them. Their habit remains the same. They because not to 50 means not sitting here in general. I'm talking. They are all laughing. No, they're not laughing with the front line or something. Then I'm also in the same category. What I'm saying is that you can't change. They say once the pot is made, then you can't change it. In Gujarati, they say, "Paake ghare kantlan." Means when the pot is already cooked, meaning that it is already made, you can't change it. So by 50, 60 is already done. Difficult to change. But you can change because children can be molded. Formative years, we can explain to them, make them see, explain means make them see what you seeing. What is called teaching is to make the student see what you see. That's our tradition in the Upanishads, in the Vedas. Not just say what you know, make them know what you know. Make them see what you see. You know, Bhagavad Gita is a dialogue between Lord Krishna and Arjuna. How many chapters are there in Bhagavad Gita, do you know? 18 chapters, right. In the 18th chapter, essentially at the end, Lord Krishna asks Arjuna, "Hey, did you listen to what I said? Did you attentively listen to what I said, Arjuna? Did you understand what I wanted to communicate? And has it transformed you from an unhappy to a happy person? Has it happened to you?" In the 18th chapter, Lord Krishna is asking this to Arjuna. If Arjuna said, "I have not understood so hard. I am still miserable." Then you what? Then Lord Krishna would be obliged to continue his discourse until the purpose of communication, not just to communicate according to syllabus and this and that, and it is required, of course, you to pass exams and get, so that skill also is required, I won't deny that. But purpose of education is to learn and grow. Inner growth in our inner maturity and understanding, because that's the means of happiness. Passing examination is a means of income, which is required. But learning is the means of inner maturity, which is a means of happiness. So therefore we should explain these differences to our students. And we are not suggesting that worldly things are not, they are important. Provided they are accompanied with maturity, then they become a blessing to you, otherwise same thing becomes a curse. Power is a blessing, provided in the right hands, otherwise it's a curse. That goes with everything. So, thus, what the basic values are, how valuable they are, and how they make you a happy person. And what is success? Success is in happiness. It's not other way around. Happiness is a mark of success. Success is not the mark of happiness. Happiness is a mark of success. So make them truly successful people. Is the purpose of values for ourselves and of course for others also. So with that, I'll take a break and are there any questions, immediate questions? Yes, sir. Kindly give, can you speak in the microphone?
Swamiji, you make many valuable points, and I see that there is a distinction between a consumer and a contributor. Also, I'm seeing how would we implement that practically. Okay, right now we are engaged in such a competitive environment that the goal of education is not to enlighten yourself or anything, but it is to achieve a result. Constantly, when you're aiming at results, say practically speaking, when you're aiming at completing the portion, a teacher is like killing herself trying to finish portion.
Parents, say that again.
A teacher is killing herself trying to finish the portion, syllabus. Parents are worried about results. So if constant focus is on outcomes, then where is the time for spiritual evolution? How do you find that time?
Very good. So it is true that what is important is the outcome, which is fair. I mean, we can't, you know, that is how we are judged. Outcome is called the end, and the process or effort is called the means. Effort and outcome. Effort is the means, outcome is the end. So end is important. But if you have a basic value, that I will not compromise means for the sake of end. That yes, outcome is important, I want that outcome. You want to score marks and you want a good job and you want good performance. But where the values come is that I will not compromise means for the sake of end. Because end doesn't make you happy, means, right means make you happy. End is whatever, wealth, name, fame, whatever, that's end. What it means? Your honesty, your spirit of contribution, that's the means. So happiness comes from the means and not from the end. If I understood this, then I will not compromise the means. Competition is okay. But Swamiji, end only matters. People don't see how good you are, they see what you, that also is okay. What happens is that maybe you will work harder than somebody else to achieve the same result. Because people take shortcuts and get quick fix and quick result. And you may not take a shortcut. So you may have to work harder. You may be more innovative. You may be better than others, more innovative than others, work harder than us to get the same outcome. But not you cannot get. Today the equation is that if you are honest, you cannot be successful. To be successful, you have to be dishonest. This is an equation that goes around. And therefore, after we give all these talks, this and this, Swami, then they don't know what the world is. They are not practical people. But no, it is possible to be honest and still be successful. Except that he may be more innovative than us, more thinking than others, more hard-working than others, but you can be. And people are established also. There are honest people who are successful. Not that every successful is dishonest necessarily. And you find that they have a more stable business, more lasting. It may be slow progress, but then it is a steady and lasting progress. Those organizations have lasted over a long time. Others came and went. So there is a spike of success and it is gone. Spike of success, where the means are wrong, it cannot last too long. When the means are right, it may be slow, but it will be steady and long-lasting. You can look at the history of industry and business and everything. But people are all tempted by immediate gratification. You want immediate gratification. Lord Krishna says, you know, that don't fall for this temptation of immediate gratification. Be committed to your values and hard work, and the end will take care. If the means are right, end will take care. That's what Lord Krishna says, karma nyavadikaraste ma phale sukadasana. Karma means effort. If the effort is right, don't worry about the outcome. No, Swami is not right, we see many honest people. But you see, just because I am honest doesn't mean that I can be successful. You need many other aspects for being a successful person. You require hard work also, you require innovation also, you require lot of things are also required to be a successful person in the world. So I am honest, therefore I expect you to make me successful. But I need other components also. So it is not that an honest person is unsuccessful, an incompetent is unsuccessful, understand? You are competent also. I cannot take for granted that just because the person is honest, that you need other components also. But given two competent persons, the honest one will be happier in the long run than the other one. And therefore more successful, a steadily successful person. You can see the history of industrial organizations in India and abroad and everywhere. And yes, you can use your power to manipulate, which is going on around the world. The money power used to manipulate, the military power used to manipulate, the technological power, all to manipulate others, because that's where people see success. They're all wrong ways of doing things. The whole countries are doing it. Where is you and I? Nations are doing that. Big business is doing that. Immediate gratification, exploit. But that cannot go on too long. There is something called this is something called law of karma. It can catch up with you. Now that sounds superstitious, I won't talk about it. But basically, the karmanyava, the end will be incompatible compared to the means. The means are wrong, the end cannot be right all the time. Understand that? No, Swamiji, we find all dishonest persons all being prosperous. You know, there, somebody used to tell us a story, one person in Gujarat. He has written a book in which he has cited this beautiful example. There is a farmer who cultivates different kinds of grains in different seasons. In monsoon he cultivates rice, and then in winter he cultivates wheat, and then in spring he cultivates corn. Let us say, in one field is so different crops. He has a huge silo for storing these grains. The silo has an opening at the top in which you dump the grain. The silo is an opening at the bottom from which you withdraw the grain. You see? So in the monsoon, he cultivates rice and he dumps rice. Then wheat, he dumps wheat. Then corn, you see him dumping corn. When he opens, you know what he gets? You see this person dumping corn in that silo or storage. But when you open that opening at the bottom, which grain does he get? You did not listen to me. Huh? What does he get? Rice. But he's putting in corn, how can he get rice? Huh? Because he already has put it earlier, is it not so? So suppose you find a dishonest person very prosperous. You need not connect them. What he's doing now may not be connected with what he gets. Meaning what he gets now may be the outcome of what he has done in the past, who knows? But what we do in the present will catch up with us. We don't want to curse anybody, I'm just telling you our own self, that we cannot get away. The basic law in the life is called dharma, righteousness. If you violate that, we also get violated. So that also we should know. So we have to equip our children for competition, no doubt about that. We have to complete syllabus also. But that doesn't mean that you have to compromise values. We have to find ways of doing these worldly things while also not compromising the value. That will require thinking, hard work, etc. But you can do it. Anybody else?
Swamiji, very interesting philosophy, thank you so much. I'm going to ask one question about the young generation. I teach management students. Teaching young generation is a bundle of joy and pain. Bundle of joy because they all, you know, well equipped with the gadgets or whatever you give, they immediately work. The pain is, I like to relate what you said, we as a teacher, we should be value-based, so therefore you teach value and they absorb this value. When you teach value, 10% of the students, they absorb this value and they meet your expectation. But these young generations, 90% of the generations, they rebel, they find it very difficult to absorb this value-based education. So me as a teacher, and you as a very experienced guru, Guruji, Swamiji, I'd like to ask you, what is the way to inspire the same generation? Therefore, they absorb the value, if not 100%, at least 80%. Thank you.
So we have to, in fact, the case study would be a very good way of communicating. Let us do some research and find out real cases of people who have been successful and who have also had a value for these values. Because they want to see demonstration, not just this is my wonderful talk and theory, as you said, you know, wonderful philosophy, you use the word philosophy. It's not a philosophy, it's a reality of life actually. But intellectually you may be convinced also, you will be. But emotionally, our value still for this money, etc. So even though we keep on, those acquired values of success, wealth, etc. are so powerful that even when we communicate the value of these honesty, etc., still it does not sink into them because the value of success and wealth is ingrained in them strongly. So we will have to present to them some powerful examples of people who have been successful. Now we can't put on Mahatma Gandhi and stuff, that is too big an example for us. But there are many. There are many leaders, there are many, maybe famous, may not be that famous, there are many famous people also, not so famous. But there were finding real life examples and demonstrating to them that this is possible, this can happen. So at least that possibility goes in their mind that this is feasible, it is possible. They may not necessarily accept it right away, but that samskara gets into the mind that this is possible. And particularly if example of person whom they respect, if you example of Sachin Tendulkar, for example, his life and his whatever and his achievements. And not just look at the glamour, what hard work went behind this, you know. So that is also a value. That how a person, of course talent is required, no doubt about that. But there are so many people who work so hard and thus have achieved things by fair means. There may not be many, but there are sufficient numbers for us to present them as real life examples. And also, if you are convinced deeply, we can convince others if we are ourselves deeply convinced. If we ourselves are not very sure, then we are not able to communicate effectively. So number one, to understand, assimilate ourselves, look at our own life, why go anywhere else? Look at your own occasions when you are happy, when you feel happy with yourself, satisfied. Remember those events when you went out of the way to help somebody, do a little good thing. When you were a contributor now and then, and how it made you feel about yourself. And then you were a consumer and you were greedy and you got away with something, and how it made you feel about yourself. We ourselves become the example for ourselves. You don't have to go out. And so, first develop a conviction ourselves. Then it will be easier to convince others and then find out other examples. Tell your own examples. This is what I also thought and this is what I discovered. If you don't have that, look for other examples. I guess students are very shy, is it, in asking questions? No, Swami, you are intimidating, you know, you are just dressed and stuff like that. How can I talk to you? Is that something like that? As it is, this is very strange, you know. Normally, very often happens that I enter your college and people are leaving, you know. When they find a Swami is coming, then this is. So they think Swami is a funny part. But Swami also is sort of like you, not too different. Wears different clothes, okay. But not a different creature with horns and stuff like that. Yes.
Yeah. Good morning, everyone. My humble namaste to you, Swami. My question is, I deal with the smaller children, and it starts at a very basic level where you impart the values, and they are very quick learners, and they learn it also very quickly. And immediately they come the next day, that after applying, sometimes they face some difficulties, and then they come up with the help because they seek the help from the one who have got the advice from. And of course, we give the answers, but at a certain time you already know that it is very difficult to explain them that how somebody is wrong and how they are right. And I feel if we get a better answer for them, they would be, you know, taking it further. When you don't have the answer to explain that you did the right thing, but still, in the return, you did not get what you were expecting. So I just need a help that how do you help the children?
Very good question. Meaning that actually practicing value is a painful process. More often than not, to be honest is a painful process. To be kind, meaning that to be a giver, is a painful process, because to grab is the usual basic instinct, is to grab. And we have to change our instinct from being a grabber to a giver. Now that requires an internal work. At the same time, when we teach the values, we should also teach them our own limitations. Meaning that whenever we practice a value, it always, more often than not, involves pain, because we will let go something. To be honest, I should let go the benefit of being dishonest. See, nobody will be dishonest unless there is benefit. Nobody will tell a lie unless there is a benefit. Nobody will hurt others unless there is a benefit. That means that to be honest, to be kind, I have to let go the benefits of being cruel or being selfish. What benefits? The worldly benefits. It may bring me some, I can dominate somebody, intimidate somebody, I can get some money, whatever it is. So some worldly gain is involved in violating the value. And more often than not, that worldly loss is involved in following a value. You understand what I'm saying? And it is painful because I have value for money. There is a lot of attachment to things, and to part with that becomes painful. So yes, this is a good question that gives an opportunity to also clarify that it is not immediately easy to follow the value because of whatever orientation has been, because to us all these worldly things are very valuable, and therefore to let go becomes very painful. They said, to tell that customs officer what I was carrying would involve letting go a couple of lakhs of rupees. That's very painful. And therefore, we have to be ready to suffer the pain for the sake of following their value. That pain is a means of happiness. It is ultimately, because I will feel proud of myself. I told this, I told truth, I let go of this, I feel I am strong. It gives me an inner strength and, you know, a self-worth, a self-confidence, self-esteem. We lose self-esteem because we just violate the values. A person who is dishonest cannot respect himself, cannot. Therefore, we lose respect for our own self. When you follow the value, I feel worthy in my own perception. But a price is involved in terms of that pain of letting go something to which I am attached, which is wrong attachment, but right now it is painful. You know what I am saying is true is that when we teach this value at any level, we also have to make them aware of the pain involved. If you teach the value of being generosity by the example of Karna in Mahabharata, Yudhisthira, what pain he went through. This is just an example I am giving you. You give other example. Yudhisthira, for example, what Pandavas had to go through in terms of following the dharma. Little Rama had to suffer for 14 years in, you know, exile in forest for following dharma. There are extreme examples of how pain is involved in following dharma or values. But ultimately, dharma rakshati, there is a saying which says, dharma rakshati rakshitaha. When we protect the dharma, dharma protects us. But now, a child may not be able to understand all this. But you tell the child some known stories and show that yes, some pain is involved, but ultimately how the victory comes in long term. Because when you follow a value, expect appreciation from others. You got immediate benefit you always want. When it does not come, we get disappointed. See, disappointment comes because we do not get immediate gratification. That's what we want. When I am kind to you, I expect some smile from you. I expect a thank you from you at least. When that does not come forth, I get disappointed. When I help you, some expectation is there, at least some appreciation, you know, some kind words. When they do not come, I feel disappointed. So pain comes not because I am honest, pain comes because for being honest, I have an expectation of return favor that does not come. So it is the unfulfilled expectation that makes me unhappy, not being honest. Honest makes me happy with myself. But with that honest, I also have an expectation that when I do something for you, you should also do something for me. Now that is a means or a source of unhappiness, that expectation. So that will take time. Swami, naturally we have expectation. When you do something, there is an expectation. A time will come, then we do something for the sake of doing, then it's the right way of doing things. But not right away. So understand that even in being good person, there is an expectation that people should appreciate my goodness. When I cook food for 10 guests, and when they go, come and eat, enjoy food and go away, I feel disappointed. So nobody appreciated Swamiji. Nobody said a word about it. Meaning that we always have expectation of some reward in whatever we do. It is that expectation that is painful more than anything else. But understand, this is there. So next time you do something, make note that I am doing this because of the expectation. Mind, do you want to retain the expectation or you want to give up that expectation? If you can give up that expectation, you have one sense of, you have made one victory. So explain the limitations of value, that value involves pain. And everybody has a limitation of how much pain I can put up with. And tell them that you follow value until you can. When you feel you cannot, let go. You be, even Yudhishthira also, Yudhishthira, the eldest of the Pandava? Truthful person, isn't it? But now came the point where Dronacharya's, he was invincible, he would have destroyed Pandavas, he had to be killed. That can only happen if Yudhishthira tells a lie. And so, all these stories, isn't it? Ashwatthama hataha, Ashwatthama is killed, so Bhima declared. Drona doesn't believe, he says, Bhima, Yudhishthira should say that. So Lord Krishna says, Yudhishthira, hey, you say Ashwatthama is killed. That was Ashwatthama who was an elephant. What Ashwatthama, real meaning for Dronacharya was his son. But Ashwatthama hataha, Dronacharya, I won't say that because he's not killed. He's killed, Lord Krishna says, Ashwatthama is killed. You don't say his son or something. So he was able to persuade Yudhishthira. See, there's a little weak point and then there's always forces around you that can exploit you. Even Yudhishthira also was persuaded by Lord Krishna because they wanted victory or whatever it is. So there are all these kind of things within ourselves and therefore we are vulnerable. You know what is vulnerable? We are vulnerable. We should understand. We are likely to fail. Doesn't matter. But understand the boundaries of value and tell them.
Concerned or powerful for larger population. As you're talking about Mahabharata, so I think Krishna manipulated so many things in Mahabharata just to achieve the dharma or the victory of dharma. Do you think it is right way to manipulate things in order to achieve which is good for the larger population?
In principle, yes. But in reality, you have to be very careful with yourself. That you are manipulating purely as an act of contribution. This thing came with Lord Krishna also.
Yeah. And as you were saying, when Drona also, when he asked Eklavya his thumb, what was the need of asking his thumb? Because he wanted to show Arjuna.
That was the wrong thing to do.
Yeah.
Now we can't condone that.
Yeah.
But Lord Krishna is a different entity. So you gave the example of Lord Krishna who apparently manipulated many things.
So
now came a test of Lord Krishna, of his inner being. Subsequent to all this battle was over, and Ashwatthama, when he learned that Drushtadyumna had killed his father and Pandavas are responsible, therefore he said, I'm going to kill all the Pandavas, and he killed what looked like Pandavas, they were his sons. And then he realized that, and ultimately Ashwatthama was so angry that He sent a Brahmastra to Uttara's womb. And then Uttara, so she was crying and urging Lord Krishna, please save this child. Everybody say, because he's the only successor. So Lord Krishna says that during the 18 days of battle, if there was no partiality in my mind, even for a moment, that I was partial to Pandavas and cruel to Kauravas, if that partial was not there ever, then may this child become alive. So Lord Krishna manipulated without any personal agenda. Now we are not up to that point, by the way. When we manipulate, very likely there is likely to be a selfish agenda behind that. In the name of doing good to others, we may be also doing good to ourselves. But we have to be careful about that. It's a very risky thing to justify doing the wrong thing for a right end. Involves a lot of inner inquiry, and mostly it is wrong thing to do. But there can be a situation where perhaps doing what appears to be wrong brings about a very large goodness, then you may be able to justify that, as long as your personal agenda is not involved.
From a very early age, and that should start with our parents. After parents, teachers are the ones that input in children. But if you see our academics from a very early age, that is from senior KG onwards, there is a poem that we teach to every student, that is Johnny Johnny Yes Papa. And that poem teaches a child to lie. Then how we are inputting value in that?
Good, I don't know that poem, you know, because I didn't, but anyway, I'm...
Okay, so the poem was like, Johnny, Johnny, yes, Papa, eating sugar, no, Papa, telling lies, no, Papa, and at the end of that, the dad asked the child to open your mouth, so he get caught, like, yes, he is eating that sugar. So that is teaching the child to lie.
No. This teaching the child how you will be caught if you tell a lie. No. You cannot get away with a lie.
Yes, but initially the child is saying no, even though he is eating that sugar. But that is not putting any kind of...
No, that is, as I said, everybody has a tendency to lie to protect yourself. Because you know you will be punished. So you don't want to be punished. They will tell a lie. But then, telling lie will be exposed today or tomorrow. That's the story, that's the lesson from here.
Thank you.
There. Can you raise the volume? Yes, please.
We live in a world which is full of stress. Especially my teachers and whole fraternity. We go through this kind of stressful period during assessment or even my inculcating, you know, values and children.
Keep it a little closer to your mouth. Yeah. So let us see, is the stress because there is a lot of work we have to do in a short time? Is it because of the demand upon us that we have to produce that there is stress? We will tell you what is the cause of stress. It is not a situation which is necessarily stress or causes stress. It is not what is expected out of us that causes stress. That we do a lot of things in a short time, they need not cause stress. What causes stress is the expectation that I should be successful, that this should be the outcome. It is a concern about the outcome that causes the stress and not so much the effort. We equate stress with effort. So much I have to do, Swamiji. That need not cause stress. It meant cause for planning and whatever it is, and hard work. But will I be successful? What will people think? Will I get the job? Will I pass the exam? Will this happen to me? Will I be successful, basically? And what is my definition of success? Passing exam is success. Securing this is a success. Getting job is a success. More salary is success. So will I be successful? I mean, will I get these things or not? It is this expectation, and because I cannot control the outcome, when I make an effort, if I could control the outcome, no stress. If you are hungry and you are eating food, is there stress in there? No stress, you enjoy ice cream because you know that you are going to digest it. But suppose it happened to you, other day you ate ice cream from some shop and then all kinds of problems were there in your stomach. Next time when you eat ice cream, there is a question, what will it do to my stomach? What will be the outcome? It is the concern about the success, because I only can accept myself if I am a successful person. I cannot accept myself if I am a failure. That's what the world has taught me, that you must be successful. From childhood also, this is what I was expected, to be successful. And therefore I demand that I should be successful. Unfortunately, success is outcome. I cannot control the outcome. Meaning that I cannot be sure whether I will be successful or not. I want to be successful, but I cannot be sure whether I will be. That's what causes stress. The uncertainty causes stress. Uncertainty about the favorable outcome is what causes stress. There is no stress if you are willing to accept whatever outcome comes. Karmanyavadikaraste ma phaleshu kadai. Lord Krishna says that your duty is to do the right effort. Do not judge yourself by the outcome, judge yourself by the effort. Unfortunately, the world judges you by outcome. But what we are telling you, for your own self, it is true that we want the best outcome, we don't deny that. But when I make an effort, how am I going to judge myself? The world will judge me by its own standard, that's okay. Understand that our happiness or unhappiness is not determined by what the world says about me. My happiness or unhappiness is decided by what I say about myself. Understand this. Even if the world declares me a failure, as long as I feel I am not a failure, it would not matter to you. Even the world calls you a successful person. If you think you are not successful, you are not happy. Think about this and go to your own past experiences. Understand that what matters to my happiness is what I think of myself. And therefore, I cannot accept myself a failure. And I judge myself based on outcome which I cannot control. Lord Krishna says, judge yourself based on effort which you can control. Do not judge yourself based on outcome which you cannot control. We always judge ourselves based on outcome. And we can't control, so we are never sure. That uncertainty causes stress. You follow? So what? How to deal with that? Willingness to gracefully accept whatever outcome comes. Or not judging myself by the outcome, judging myself by the effort. Did I make the right effort? Did I do the most I could do? Yes, then I have all the reason to be happy. Outcome, because I don't control. Outcome is controlled by so many factors beyond my control. There are so many variables, isn't it? There is many a slip between a cup and a lip, isn't it? There is many a slip between a cup and a lip. A cup and lip I can control. The slip I cannot control. I should not judge myself by that. This is a very fundamental lesson about the life. That we always judge ourselves, number one. That's our habit. And because the world has taught us to judge ourselves by outcome, so we judge ourselves by outcome and declare our own self, I'm a failure. Whether the world declares me before that, I declare myself. World may declare me a successful person, I may declare myself a failure. Gandhi, you thought he was a failure, imagine. Gandhi, you thought that he was a failure. Why? Because he had an expectation of some outcome, of how people should be transformed, ahimsa, etc. Whatever it is. What I am saying is that whole world thinks he was the most successful person. But whether he thought so or not, what is important to us is how we perceive ourselves. And if you are an honest, good person, you will always perceive yourself as successful. Because then effort will become important, not outcome. Otherwise, outcome is important for the world. That's where the stress is.
Pranam Swamiji.
You are, okay, yeah.
Being a primary teacher, I have seen that kids don't value money. Like, how to input the value of money? Like, valuing the money?
No. When you say don't value money, means that they don't care for how much money is spent. Because they get what they want. Parents just give the purse is loose, and therefore nobody will value anything which comes free. Nobody will value something which doesn't cost you anything. Children don't care because the fathers finance them. Our Indian parents in US, for example, when their children go to college, they give their own credit card to them. Now this mother or father will think 10 times before, because he's an Indian person and born here. That fellow, he's Indian, but otherwise he's American. He goes and spends freely with father's credit card. He treats his friends in restaurants and movies and this and that, and this fellow gets hundreds and thousands of the bill. You don't care when you don't have to work for it. You don't know the value of money. Because you did not earn it. If the father, when we were growing up, there was no money anywhere around. But even if you get one anna those days, my mother would give me an anna. They would never give anywhere by money. But still, if I say, "Mom, I want to eat this," then do this. So immediately we had to work for getting anything. Then we knew the value of it. Then you won't squander it. Children squander the money because they have no value, because they don't know what it takes to have 1 rupee or 100 rupees or what it is. So we have to teach them how money comes, how you earn money, what all it takes, to get money. That somebody has worked so hard in giving you 100 rupees, which are just squandering like that. So we have to make them see this. You follow? All right, I guess we have run out of the time now. So. Oh, this one. So, do you want to continue, or what is our time schedule, etc.? 12:30. So, we are done with the time. All right. Okay. So, today's lesson, I guess. Am I successful or not? Huh? All right. It's important. But you call me successful.
The best and beautiful things in the world
cannot be seen or even touched. They must be felt by heart. Thank you is one such prayer among them. On behalf of Arsat management and all the members of the Arsat family, I would like to thank Pooja Swami Vivekanandji for enlightening us with his knowledge and wisdom today. So much takeaway. Let's not be tempted for immediate gratification. The law of karma, the law of dharma and righteousness, abuse of values, no pressure, no violation of values, definition of happiness, self-satisfaction, the two sets of values in life, the two ways to lead life, whether as a consumer or a contributor. When we protect dharma, dharma protects us. The cause of stress, which is directly related to outcome and our concern for success, are not being able to accept failure. Judge yourself on your effort and not on your outcome. And I like the Johnny, yes, Papa. I'm sure all of you would agree that Swamiji gave us a real explanation of the truth of the poem. I think before the question came up, we would all have been in a common mindset that yes, the child was told to tell lies, but then that was our interpretation, and beautifully Swami brought out the truth of the poem. The child tells lies and he comes to know that the punishment for the lies is also there. That was wonderful. Thank you so much, Swamiji, from the bottom of my heart, our deepest and sincere gratitude. Our sincere gratitude is also due to Sri Jayesh Vaishnav for bringing forth this divine connect for all of us today. My sincere thanks to our President, Sri Ashokji Saraf, for coordinating and making this meet happen in our own campus. A big thank you to all the managing committee members of Rajasthani Sammelan Education Trust, the institute heads, staff members, and all other members of RCET for attending this event and making it a grand success. I'm sure each one of us has some takeaway from Swamiji's discourse. Stay blessed. Thank you.